So, hi everyone, and namaste, Mr. Chaudhary, Kavita, and Yogesh, and thank you, Ram, and welcome everyone. So, it will be really an inspiring session today, and I must acknowledge that Mr. Chaudhary was not keeping all that well. We just spoke about 2 hours ago, and there was a very little possibility that he would be able to join. But it is indeed gracious of him and courageous of him that is overcoming that odd of health. And then he decided to join us. So thank you very much, sir, for joining us. And Jaipur rugs, when you think, few keywords that come to our mind, and we are keyword-driven world today. So I wouldn't describe much, but just use few keywords. And many of you would know about him, his life story, and the kind of empire that he has built, which is built on Gandhian principles. So one keyword is coming to my mind is Gandhian principle, sustainable business, well-being for all, livelihood for artisans, and also the subverting the pyramid rather than top to bottom, bottom to top, and some amazing stuff that he will talk about. Truly inspiring as a person, very humble. And also, since all of you are from coaching community, I can say that he also is not only a recipient of coaching, but also a big sponsor of coaching. And he believes that coaching can transform people, organizations, and also the world at large. He is truly a believer in coaching and also practitioner. So he has said one thing to me a few days ago, which truly resonated with me. And that's where I will take a pause and hand over to Ram. He said that in every atom of my organization, I want to see coaching. So just like as air or an oxygen, he would like coaching to be present in every nook and corner of his organization. So that is truly heartening, sir. And thank you and your children to join us today. Once again, I welcome you, and over to you, Ram, before Chaudhry Saab comes in.
Yeah. Sure, Jewel. Thank you. Thanks, Mr. Chaudhary. Thanks, Kavita. Thanks, Yogesh, for joining us today. It's not many times that I could really honestly say authentically that I have great pleasure in being in a colloquium. Most often I do that because that's part of my job. But today, truly, it's a pleasure for multiple reasons. Way back, almost about 40 years ago, I spent almost about 8 to 9 years working at the village level in India, in one of the most backward spots of India, in a place called Uttar Pradesh. Ironically, with a company which was a colonial flashback in Unilever, but amazingly great company. And my task at that time was to revive a business operation in this rural part of India by working at the village level to make it relevant to the villagers and by using them as sources of supply by enhancing their livelihood and quality of life. We eventually set up over about 2 to 3 years. We turned around this place, which was running at pretty break-even or losses, and grew that into a cooperative of about 200 plus rural entities, the villages. And at that time, it was, for those of you who are familiar from the Indian context, probably almost next in size to what was then the greatest and the biggest in India, the Amul Cooperative, Milk Cooperative, founded by Dr. Kurian. One of the things I learned, and one of the things that Unilever did, was that it had every single management trainee of that company spend 2 to 3 months in the villages. And they actually spent 2 months living in those villages. And these were kids who were from the IITs and IIMs, the equivalent of the Harvards and the MITs of the United States, who had never ever before visited villages, and they had to really bathe in the open in the village wells and all kinds of stuff and eat the kind of food they'd never been used to. And today, whenever I meet many of them, and many of them are today managing directors and CEOs and such like in very, very large companies, including multinationals in India. And one of the things that they always talk about, as I do myself, is how inspirational it was for us to have spent our time there and working with people at the village level, and how much we learned from them, from their wisdom. So one of the things that insights, learning that I gathered from there, which was probably one of my most inspiring parts of my life, which helped me right through my life later on, and today drives many of the visionary things that I would like to happen through Coacharya, is that a concept which I started calling the barefoot leadership. That leadership doesn't necessarily exist in people who have been through the portals of the great institutes of management in India or in the United States or any such places. They don't, to be honest. Those barefoot leaders are there at every level if you just seek them. And they may not be aware that they are leaders. And one of the aspirations, the visionary aspirations of Coacharya, is to make them aware of the fact that they are true leaders, the same way as they're all barefoot coaches or barefoot healers. And something that I very often speak about, we've got some blogs on our website, so it's nothing new. And then suddenly, last year, in some context, I met Mr. Chaudhary, or I heard about him. So I wrote to him, and then first had a conversation with one of his colleagues, and eventually had a talk with him. And I found that he has created from nothing, against the wishes of his family in a sense, taking a radical maverick role. Today, a community of 50,000 women in the state of Rajasthan and the neighborhood, where these people, most of them, for the most part, and they can clarify all that, they are from what in India traditionally called the lower caste of society, one of the biggest scourges of India, evils of India. Far worse than you can imagine as racialism in any country. This is something which plagues this country, which we need to get rid of. They are working with them, uplifting them. They are from these communities. They are women. They are poor. What more can you add? And we would like to talk a little bit about what they have managed to do. And the most interesting part of it was, as I talked to Mr. Chaudhary, and which is why then I got Ujjwal involved in it, and another person, Mukta, who's not here today, both of them have worked with such programs with different people before. He said that I would like to create a coaching culture in my company. And I was quite surprised, because that was not the reason why I wanted to talk to him. I had heard that he had presented programs with Otto Sharma on Theory U and various other kind of people. And he had had interviews and formal conversations with the chief executive of Hire, who talks about the Upanishads. I heard that interview and I was blown out of my mind. This man, Hire, is probably today overtaken General Electric and various other companies as the biggest consumer goods manufacturing company, consumer durable manufacturing company in the world. And this guy, I don't remember some words, some amazingly powerful concept that he talked about, Vedic concepts. And he really knew what he was talking about, because I'm a student of the Vedic scriptures. And so even though I may not know everything, I understand if somebody is talking about it. And then he comes and says, look, I want to create a coaching culture. And I said, why do you want to do that? He says, we would like people to be treated with respect. We would like communications to be open. We would like to create a structure where there is no one formal leader and everybody is equal and they are working in that space. And so I don't want to waste too much of your time today talking about this. I can go on for hours talking about Mr. Chaudhary in another forum. But today I would like him and his daughter Kavita and son Yogesh to talk about it. Mr. Chaudhary can talk about the origins of how we built this up. And Kavita, we just learned, she studied at the School of Arts in Chicago, one of the highly renowned places in United States or in the world, where I've had the pleasure of visiting that place several times. Amazing place. And Yogesh too studied in the United States. They have come back and they are working with him, running this operation, which unfortunately, I don't think enough number of people know about them. This is a sad part of it, about the kind of work that they do, like about the magic that they have created in the lives, the miracle that they have created in the lives of these 50,000 women or more. It's always growing. And over and above that, introducing the whole concept of coaching, which they believe is going to help them. So Ujjwal is actually working with them in a program where both with their staff at the headquarters, as well as at the grassroots level with many of these people whom they are helping. So I'll stop here, pass it over to Mr. Chaudhary and then to Kavita, and Ujjwal will take care of in terms of creating a flow in this conversation. Thank you, sir, once again. Thanks, Mr. Chaudhary. Thanks, Kavita. Thanks, Yogesh, for being here. Over to you, sir, please.
Thank you. Thank you. So after passing my BCom, I took an admission in a university. The name of the university is University of Hard Rocks of Life. And my real education began from that university. So today I will talk of my experience is I learned from that university. I started my career selling shoes from a little shop which my father have started in Churu. And at that time, I also got permanent service in a nationalized bank. I declined the offer as I wanted to do something of my own. And I was not enjoying working at my father's shop. So at that time, I started introspecting myself. Who am I? What are my natural capabilities? What are my natural abilities? And what I must do? So at that time, I realized that there were very less weavers in India for carpet making, and the demand of the carpet were very huge. So I thought that I must start from this business. And if I start this business, I have a chance to meet the people of the rejected people. So I borrowed 5,000 rupees from my father, $200 from my father, and buy two looms and an old cycle to travel to the weaver houses. And I started these two looms in my own home. After I started this business, I saw that most of the weavers were men and they were not very disciplined, creating so many problems. But after some time, there were some women and I found they were very disciplined, and I learned very early that then I decided to always work on the women. So most of 85% of our viewer is still women. After starting this business, the first challenge which I faced is from my own family members, because at that time, weavers belong to the untouchable class and were not giving the same social standing as others in India. So everybody, my neighbors, my family members, my relatives, they try to stop me to work with the untouchable people. And that at that time I realized that how we can judge a person on the caste. A person should be judged by the purity of his thought and the purity of his karma. And at that time, I realized that in the society where I live is hypocrite. People is something else as his home, something else in temple, something else in his office, and something else when he's alone. but I fell love with the weavers and weaving. So I used to take my lunch with the weavers and spend most of time with the weavers. And I learned the basic of the weaving from those weavers. So I worked as a contractor manufacturer for 9 years. And after that, I shifted to Jaipur to start my own export with my brother. But after I started my own export, I found the demand was so huge. Germany was the biggest customer for the carpet. So I need more weaver, and I heard that the Gujarat government is trying to develop the carpet weaving in a tribal area. There is a very big tribal area in Gujarat. So I went there to inquire about that area. So on the very first day, the local people stopped me that if you go to that area, people can beat you, they can tear your clothes, and they are not very welcoming to the outsider. So I have got an English friend who lives in England. So whenever I have some problem, I always take his advice. So I called him that people are saying me that I must not start work here because tribals are not very good people. Then he told me that tribal are the most innocent people in India. People from outside, they exploited them badly. So they don't trust them. So if you deal with them love and compassion and like your family members, that will be your biggest loyal force. By taking his advice, I started working in that area. After 3 years, I was like a mentor and guide for them. They liked me so much that whenever I go to the village to meet the weavers, their parents greeted me outside their home. And I was the most famous person in that area within 3 years. I stayed there for 8 years. And in this time, I trained 15,000 tribal men and women in the art of carpet weaving. And still we are getting the most expensive, the best quality carpet from that area. At that time, the whole area is full with hills, rivers, and there is no landline, no mobile. So I took the permission from the Gujarat government and I put the repeater and I was communicating with the walkie-talkie throughout the area. At that time, I was blessed with 3 daughters. So in those days, if a woman had the first 3 daughters, the family members see them with a very inferior eye. So my wife was always telling me that I don't know what is the trouble with the daughters. So one day I asked my English friend that what do you think, how to solve this problem? I don't know what is the mistake if I have got the 3 daughters. He told me that, Nandu, you are very lucky that you have got the first 3 daughters, because in your society, they differentiate between the boy and the girl. So most of the boys get spoiled and women remains far behind. So you are very lucky that women are more efficient and more receptive than the men. And he told me that you don't differentiate. I took his advice, sent all my daughters to study in America. And when my first daughter decided to go to America for the higher study, she asked me that, Papa, what is your expectation? I told her that I always enjoyed working with the weavers. So I'm a weaver. So if you go to America for the study, you must never forget that you are a daughter of a weaver. And the end consumer of my carpet is the American woman. So when you study in USA, you always see how they decorate their house, how they wear their clothes, how their mindset is changing. So when you come back to India, you have a better understanding of the customer needs. And all my three daughters took my advice and they created a big change in the industry. When I was going in the villages, I always found that those women who never went to school, they are from untouchable class, but still they are the most wisest person, because a woman who has such a limited income and who had got 10 to 12 people in his family, she managed budget, she managed marriage, she managed health, she managed clothes, food, everything, and still take time to weave the carpet. Probably they are the best managers in the world. In 1999, I separated from my brother and started Jaipurag from zero. After I started Jaipurag, in first 3 years, I have got very big challenges. And I lost all the money which I earned in my whole life. Then again, I started deep introspection. What went wrong? And I realized that I have got a very good name in making the quality carpet. So after I started Jaipurag, I have got the false feeling of goodness. I thought that if I can make the good quality carpet, I can do anything. So I learned that I am suffering with a false feeling of goodness, and good is the enemy of best. And when I researched on the internet, I found that it is a mental disease called euphoria. So I was really frightened that I have this mental disease. And the second thing which I realized of my failure is that I was everywhere. I was in each decision, in each action. And I found that I was like an ice cube. So if I want to grow, I have to be water. I must, so it may take any shape. And then I started learning. I started meeting so many successful people. I started reading the books. And I also learned that I worked in my whole life in the villages, but now I have to run a global business. So I have to change my leadership style. I have to change my habits. I have to change my perception. And I have to develop so many new skills to run a global business. And still the journey of my learning is going on. That is why I understand the real meaning of coaching. After all my five children who were studying in USA, they started joining this business one by one. And when the second generation joined the business, because they have the very great exposure of the world, so my business started growing like the wildfire. To sustain the growth of the business, I have to hire fresh and experienced professionals. But all these educated people put me upside down. At the time, I realized that knowledge is power, but knowledge gained without practice develops ego. One can get lost in knowledge without knowing anything about the reality. And I learned that knowledge is the problem. So we started an initiative which we named the Higher School of Unlearning. I ask all my professionals that you must learn from the people working on the processes. I know they are uneducated, but whatever they do very well. So you must learn about the process. You must understand these people. And I also took the accountability to coach them. And at that time, I realized that the ego is the root cause of all the problems. So then we developed a philosophy, finding yourself through losing yourself. Finding yourself through losing yourself. The more I lose myself, the more I find myself. In 2004, one day I was reading in a book, management book, that business problem is the people's problem. And at that time, I was adding 5,000 to 7,000 viewers each year because business was growing very, very fast. So I thought that this problem is also, I'm getting more and more people. So one day I will be in the problem. So before the problem comes, I must find the solution. So then I started Jaipurak Foundation to create a difference in the life of the people and to have the heart-to-heart connection with all the women working at the grassroots. Jaipurak Foundation designed so great leadership development program that they changed their mindset and their leadership went to the next level. In 2008, one day I was sitting in my office and I got a phone call. The man says that I'm C.K. Pahlad. I think everybody knows about C.K. Pahlad. In 2000, he was the number one management guru globally. So I thought, why this big man, the greatest man of the world, is calling me? I thought that he has dialed wrong number. And then he asked me that, are you Mr. Chaudhary? I became very disciplined. And he told me that, Mr. Chaudhary, do you know me? I told him that, who does not know you, sir? Everybody know you. He told me that he wanted to do a case study on my business model. And that was the first time that I heard about the word business model or case study. I told him that CK, I'm a very simple person. And whatever we do is very simple. If you ask my neighbor, what is Jaipurak, who is N.K. Chaudhary? Nobody knows me. So do you think that these simple things, anybody would like to read it? Then he told me that, Mr. Chaudhary, your global supply chain is connecting the poorest of the poorest with the richest of the richest by enhancing capability at the grassroots. So then he did a 41-page case study in his book, Fortune at the Bottom of the Pyramid. The first case study is of Jaipurak, which is now taught in all the best colleges of the world. After talking to him, I realized that we have done something right. The first is the vertical integration. All the processes either owned by us or highly influenced by us. The second thing is that since I started this business, we were directly going to the weavers. We provide each and every all the services, all the raw material, all service at the doorstep of the weavers. And the whole world carpet industry is driven by the middleman. I never worked with a middleman in my life. And not working with a middleman may be very dangerous. I remember a story that one day I was sitting in my Gujarat office. A man came with a small gun and showed me the gun that, "Mr. Sodhi, either you leave Gujarat, otherwise you have to face the challenges." At that time, I realized that it is a frustration of his failure, because the whole tribal community, they love me. So I was very confident. And then he went back. In 2014, we started a project which name is Man Chaha. Mancha means, my daughter Kavita will tell about that, because that was Mancha project, that was her baby. But I want to tell you that this Mancha project has won 8 global awards. The design created by those uneducated women has won 8 global awards. In 2017, Bimla Devi, who never went to school and she's from an untouchable class, went to Germany to take the design award with my daughter. So when I started this business, I saw women. In these women, I never saw those are the rejected women, they can't do anything. I saw the same human things which I have. But my daughter Kavita went one step further. And she went and she saw God within them. And God is always creative. She will tell her story. How she saw the God within them. In 2019, last year, Raj Sisodia wrote a book, The Healing Organization. The book says that how the business can heal the society and how the business can heal the customer. He took 25 case studies globally, and his first case study is of Jaipur Lab. He says that the power of innocence in the business, the power of authenticity. And in the last, he says that Jaipur is going to be a global business ashram. Our tagline is that we don't sell carpet, we sell family blessings, we sell stories, we sell experiences, and our carpet is free. The blessing of the weaver goes to our customer, that heals them, and the happiness of the customer come back to our artisans. It completes the circle, which we said the totality. In the end, I would like to say one story. When I was in last year of my graduation, one day, my business administration professor came to my class and called out a roll number and asked me to stand. And I was very frightened that why he will punish me, because I thought I am a very disciplined student. I never did any mischievousness. So then he took out a test copy in his hand and told the whole class that see what the answer this boy has written. The question was, what is the definition of business? And what I replied is, business is next to love. It is the creator and preserver of civilization. The professor said to the whole class that this boy will become a unique businessman one day. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Kavita. And I'm the third daughter. So I have two older sisters and two younger brothers. So I'm the designer of the family. And I'll just briefly start by how I actually got into the carpet business. So I think as a child, I actually was able to travel a lot with my father to the villages. And during that time, I was able to see these tribal communities and move through very beautiful locations in the tribal belt, the hills and the forest, like my father just mentioned. So while my father used to work with the weavers, I used to go around the village and explore the women and their homes and everything. Like that. But then as I understood and saw the carpet industry as a child, the buyers who used to come from the US and the other countries, it was more than 20, 25 years ago, because everything was pure commodity, the carpet was a pure commodity, money was the only orientation, you know, they only came to bargain and, you know, they came to buy prices and never really came to buy carpets. And I never really saw any respect with these buyers at that time, any awareness about this beautiful art of carpets and the people in the community. It was purely a commodity. So because of those, that reason, I was never really interested in this industry. Being an artist, I was exploring interior design. And then I thought maybe I should try fashion. And during some of my classes in summer in Parsons in New York, I realized that I actually love textiles, you know? And that's what I enjoy more than even fashion and interior design. So I joined the program in Chicago and took on, you know, classes in screen printing and weaving and different kinds of dyeing. And at that time, after traveling around the globe, I realized how much you know, I have a passion for this thing and my family's action to weaving. So it was the first time I saw this industry in a whole new way. And I think since childhood, my father had always wanted that we should join the business, although he never told us. He never exposed his secret, but he wanted us to, you know, be able to make the decision. And I think very naturally, I was able to get pulled into the business. And, you know, I was more like the artist rather than the designer. So I never really understood what the customers wanted, they didn't want. And so I was just always learning on the ground. And carpets, I realized it's such a intense industry. You have to really spend, you know, years and years to really understand what is happening. You know, it's such a fine art. So maybe I'll mention about the Manchaha project. So is the screen shared already?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So I'll just go through a few examples just so you have a sense. Basically, the weavers, they're able to design their own carpets. It was a concept we were experimenting with. So they can choose the color palettes and they can choose what they want to create in the carpet without any restriction. So like my father said, many of them won these global awards. I'll run through a few examples.
So how you got this idea?
Yeah, I'll just... And so this is Bimla Devi's rug, Kamal, and you can see her in the photo. So she, in 2018, she had won the German Design Award. Next one. This is Ujwal. This is Savanka Leheria. Aspas. Deepak. So just now, so that's it. So these are just, ban kar dijiye. So these are just a few examples of some of the carpets these rural women have made. And the design language that came about was also something that we had never realized that we would discover in this sort of way. So I think how this project really started was, since childhood, because I had understood about the weavers and we had seen that they were very creative, traveling to all these remote parts of the tribal belts in Gujarat and Rajasthan. There was this one girl, one of the times, she was wearing this orange dupatta in Rajasthan, and her dupatta had this embroidered little thing. So I asked her, "What is this?" And she said, "This is my best friend's name." And I said, "Wow, you would embroider your best friend's name into your dupatta." She's like, "Yeah, she's my best friend." So this is one of the examples, meaning how I thought it was so original, so authentic, and how the villagers really think very differently. So we realized that there was a sense of spontaneity in many of the things that they were doing versus many of us in the cities who are very trained in thinking in a very particular way. So there was a very different approach to life, and that's what we were thinking, how to discover, how to tap into that potential of the rural women that we were seeing. On the other side, I was able to travel to Europe after my education, and I saw all these amazing designers creating like absolutely inspiring work. And at such a massive scale, meaning hundreds and hundreds of designers making the most beautiful products, you know, in all kinds of things, like not just carpets, like sofas and flooring and, you know, art, fashion. And that again inspired me a lot. But then I noticed that a lot of these designers were working with the manufacturers to create their collections, and create their brands. But I noticed that most of them didn't have the opportunity to work directly with the craftspeople or the artisans. And that's where I saw this gap, that as Jaipur Rugs, we had the opportunity to work directly with the artisans because of this wonderful network that my father had built for so many years. And the whole network, I thought, was run by the idea of trust. So the creativity of the people on one side and then the network of trust on the other side came together to become Manchaha. So we experimented with first 100 carpets, and we said, told these women that you do what you want and don't worry about the results. You just weave what you want the way you want. And so half of them were very scared. They were very afraid, and half of them were very excited to just get started. So those who are afraid, we try to guide them that you have to just trust your heart, and whatever you feel like, you just create through your heart. As long as you create through your heart, that is all that we need. And some of them, we give examples that perhaps you think that you're making this for your daughter, for your daughter's wedding. So, you know, you just need to put in your love, and that's all that we need, and nothing will be wrong. And we also told them that not to be influenced by their neighbors and other people, because often they want to look at each other. So we said, you do what you want. So basically, some of the designs that you saw, what really came out through this process is, you know, otherwise we have the design studio, and all the whole carpet industry runs through the design studios. And there are pre-subscribed drawings that the weavers get, and the weavers simply copy the patterns onto the rug. So they don't really have the creative freedom because, like I said, it has sort of become a commodity, you know, even the human art has become a commodity. And through this project, as we started, we discovered so many things were born just from spontaneously weaving on the loom. The kinds of patterns, the combinations, something we could never imagine in the design studio. And these are women, and majority of them have literally not gone outside their village. You know, that's how restricted their lives are in very simple settings. And only through the idea of spontaneity, meaning the difference in the mindset was coming from the fact that they were far more spontaneous, because life in the village sort of is very simple and relationships are more clean and warm. They don't really use their mind so much. And that's why they're able to respond very naturally without overthinking. And, you know, like even me and my design studio, we might often overthink. So I think the whole Manchaha projects runs through the idea of the heart and hand. And that is our only focus, that, you know, you create through your hand and you be connected with your hearts. And so what these women have created, we are constantly studying their artworks because they're so popular with their clients that we are wondering, how did they create this? How did they, you know, derive this? So we have to constantly always reverse engineer to figure out what they are doing. And so the design studio has become very small now because almost 500 women are in this program. They're creating their original art pieces. And many of them in these celebrity homes, winning all these wonderful awards. So and so right now we've scaled up this program in a way that we're making 10, 20 rugs a year to now say 500, now moving this year to another 1,000 to few thousands, so that we can promote more of this art worldwide. And it's really picking up a lot of pace. We're trying to, you know, keep up with the momentum of the excitement of the clients as well. And I feel very excited about this because, you know, from the whole commodification where we were producing these very complex, intricate designs, feeling very proud as designers and learning, you know, coming from the US and, you know, being feeling very smart about it. But then how cruel it was for the artisans to copy these very intricate designs and very complex pieces. They're constantly looking at the drawing, you know, trying to copy. It becomes more like a machine. The human is becoming like a machine through the commodification. And through products like Manchaha, we're able to bring it back to the human art, back to the artist. And then the rug really becomes about their life and their mindset and approach. And it connects with individual clients and the clients feel connected in a special way. So yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kavita and Mr. Chaudhary, for very, very inspiring, you know, stories that you have shared. So as I was hearing both of you, some of the words that came up for me were related to coaching, as if, you know, what you spoke is all about coaching. That's what I felt. So I felt you talked about presence. You talked about going with the not knowing. It's completely okay to go into not knowing, letting go, creating in the moment with spontaneity and allowing the flow to happen, right? So Kavita, my question to you, I have discussed a lot in details with Mr. Chaudhary, which I'll pick it up. But a question to you is that how were you able to let go that, so it's entirely reverse engineered product. So women, you are just giving them all the environment, you are holding the space, they could design and create a wow for the world. So how much was it easy or difficult for you to let go all that you know and just offer yourself?
Yeah, it's a wonderful question. I mean, I think as a child, I was very, I'm a very shy and introvert kind of person. So I always believe that I'm never good enough. I mean, that is something I think I always felt as a child. So when I was discovering this process, I didn't know enough about myself to feel, you know, very proud that I'm this and that. So it was more about, because I had so much love for them and what they did, it was more about thinking that, you know, what are they doing? How do I bring this out? Because I'm seeing something very special. Mm. Because I had so much international exposure, I could see that there was something special going on in the village and how to now showcase this to the world. So it took a long time, over many years, to connect the dots. But like I said, you know, I was more about, you know, feeling proud of them and how to bring something to the forefront.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. That again brings me to a question to both of you, and of course, Yogesh can come in anytime. So we, in coaching, we call it a trust trinity. Okay, so trusting yourself, trusting the client, their ability to create, ability to find solutions, and trust the process. So all these three things I see here, you also applied. So that's really amazing. That's really wonderful. So how in Manchaha project, as well as at a larger space in Jaipur Rugs, how did you came in touch with coaching and what is your vision as you described to me? I'm sure everybody will be more than happy to hear that how you would like coaching to be at the center stage of Jaipur Rugs to realize the vision for the future that you have?
I started working on my own consciousness and try to know who am I, why I am doing what I am doing. And I realized that I am driven by my own habits. I am driven by unconsciousness. I am the slave of my habits. And at the time, I also realized that my unconsciousness, my desires, and my ego is the biggest problem to grow this business. So I started having the introspection on the daily basis that what I did yesterday, why I did it, and ultimately, slowly, my desires, my ego, my unconscious started became my friend. I was taming them. Right. And ultimately, I realized that if I want to make my company a $1 billion company, the only thing which stops is me. Because most of the people who come to my room and ask for my advice, ask for the solutions. And ultimately, I realize that they have the better answer than me. And they are a better problem solver. And they have all the things which I have. So ultimately, I realize that if I want to make my company great, I have to lose my ego. Because in businesses, we mix, the most of the people mix their role and identity together. And they don't want to lose their identity. So the fear of losing the identity, they make the wrong decisions. So then I realized that how I may be a evidence to let the natural growth of my business happen. And then I started reading the books and meeting so many self-management people. I'm meeting most of the top class people of the world for the self-management and how they have changed the world. And then I thought that each and everybody in my company should know about the coaching, including all my viewers. So last year I thought that either everybody transform in my company. If they don't transform themselves, I will transfer them.
Yes.
I mean, Chaudhry Sahib, I don't really have many words to express what I feel at this point in time, nor do I have any questions. Actually, the only thought that I have is that if I can put you in front as a professor of unlearning in front of these chief executives of many of the multinationals that I work with, I think they can learn a lot more about how to grow their companies better than all that nonsense that is being spouted today in the name of management and leadership. That beautiful thing about that you said about seeing God in the work of these people, the concept of unlearning and shedding ego and so on. I mean, it's, to me, just spiritual. It's really what we should all be about, the purity, the innocence that we have within us. So I truly, it's for us, for Ujjwal and I, Magda and all of us, it's absolutely a pleasure to be able to work with you guys in whatever small way we are at this point in time. And like what you said, Prahlad said, or Sisodia, and probably Otto Sharma will soon, and other people, that you are going to be one of the leading lights, the beacon of wisdom, not necessarily of just knowledge, not just in the weaving industry, but in many other spaces. So I'll just thank you very, very much. I don't have words to describe this experience. Thank you, Chaudhary Saab. Thank you, Kavita. Thank you, Yogesh. So you haven't participated in the discussion. You were there in the beginning. So Ujjwal, if you would like to close the session, we are almost there on top of the hour.
Yeah, sure, Ram. Yeah, so you have summed it up very well. I just would like to request Chaudhary Saab to share his how he thinks that coaching culture can really impact the business outcomes, and how he's wanting to see coaching as the center of the people management or people leadership in his organization, especially at a grassroots level. So I think that will be a good spot to perhaps close on.
After I learned the importance of the coaching, I found a coach in Delhi, and he started coaching me. And after he started coaching me, that I see the changes which I have in my behavior, thinking, the way I see my people, it started changing. And then all my family members saw that they were able to see the change within me. That my daughter, my son, they asked me that, Papa, we also want the coaching from that coach. And I found that by changing my perception, by changing my behavior, the way I respond, the way I choose, it started making a big difference. And it changed the perception of the whole family. And everybody started talking about the billion-dollar company, that how we can create a billion-dollar company. And I also found that the changes which I have through the coaching, I tell you that within last 7 months, we have got near about 100 people, the best of the best mind of India, who have the empathy and creativity. Jaipur became such a brand in the employment market, in the best school and colleges of India, that those talented people, young people, think that if they go to Jaipur, they will get the purpose of their life. And after joining Jaipur, they will be totally a different person. And they will utilize their full potential. And I can see that we have got the thousands of viewers, and we have got so much big staff in US and here. So through the coaching, I can all bring the potential of the seed. Everybody is like a seed, and each and every seed have the potential. So through the coaching, I will be able to bring their potential of that seed. And we can see that what innovation and what will be the great future there.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Great. It's truly wonderful. And I have seen you from very close quarters, so I can say that it is a case study in the management books. But I believe that very soon, globally in coaching world, Jaipur Rugs and its weaving of coaching culture is going to be a global case study with the International Coaching Federation and entire coaching fraternity. So perhaps future organizations and future coaches are going to learn from this whole aspect that you are unveiling at Jaipur Rucks. And we are truly honored and delighted to be associated with you, sir.
Yeah, I can see the Jaipur Rucks University. The Vice Chancellor of that university is sitting out here. Okay. And the deans as well. So thank you very, very much. And I think people, the audience, the responses is so fantastic. And it's very rare, as many of them have said, to find people so authentic, so humble, and talking about the success so lightly and whatever done. And someone like you, Kavita, having studied at Parsons and Chicago School of Arts and stuff like that, and coming back and saying that you are learning what you're doing and taking the design back into the looms and reverse engineering it. I mean, it's so totally amazing. And I wish that something that you are able to expand into much larger spaces, truly. I think that will be the day when people will see the true power of what you're doing. And thank you all wonderfully. And of course, we will be interacting with you. And I'm so grateful on behalf of all the people today in the audience. Thank you, sir. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.